Hello everyone and welcome back to the channel with a repair that will blow your mind. If your inverter does not start up or shows 0 volts on the DC side, stay here as you might have found a solution to your problem. This is a Kostal Piko Solar Inverter, 10 kilowatt jobby, and it is the second time I get one within a month. The previous one gave me nightmares. I had to disassemble the whole thing twice, and if you can see, there's multiple layers of boards with hundreds of screws and standoffs. Although I was careful, I did strip a couple of bolts and one standoff was broken straight through. I had to solder all those, of course, or fix the standoffs. And even though I solve a crackling sound that was from this main board that goes to the three-phase AC, the problem was not solved as it was reported by the customer. The problem with these ones is that actually the DC side does not switch on. The symptoms with the previous one was where it would measure 0 on the AC input side and 0 on the DC input side. Although we measured, we had voltage there. Actually, this thing, as it says in the manual, needs at least 180 volts to operate the DC part of it. So this applies to all the Piko inverters that use the same DC input PCB. So the problem is very, very common across all models. Now, when a second customer asked me to take a look at this, I was very, very skeptical, as I've lost quite a few hours working on this one without any luck. What I did on the previous one is I found, let me put it this way, each PCB board has its own switch mode power supply. And if you can see, here is one, there's down there, the communication board has its own. Same goes with the board that connects to the mains. I did find a few 450 volt capacitors, a bit low on microfarad and a bit high on ESR, but nothing screamed that it would be a problem and this wouldn't operate. Now, the difference is that I managed to find a schematic for the DC input side, and straight away I realized what the problem might have been. Unfortunately, I might have missed a single component in my testing and diagnosing part, and now I get a chance to do it again. Let's go and switch it on and just confirm it is the same problem as the other one. Now let's fire it up. You can see this was probably exposed to direct sunlight. The previous display on the other Kostal inverter was absolutely like new. I have connected one phase. What I do like about this is that it doesn't matter which phase you connect, even if one is present, all the switch mode power supplies will work and it will power up. Now let's fire up the power and see it boot. So it has booted, as you can see, 1 million, so about 1.5 megawatt hours was that. And you can see we don't get any readings at all. So the inverter does have a disconnect switch right there. that operates the DC side. It is an isolator. I will try to switch it on. Nothing happens. No click from the relays there. But I'm really curious if it would operate when the DC is present or not. So as you can see, we don't get any readings either on the AC side or the DC side. So here we are back. The DC PCB, the DC input PCB is out. And this is our schematic. Now, the interesting part is just right here, where there is an IC. It's called LC, I think, 200D. That it is a PWM current sense IC, and it operates with the switch mode power supply. But when we take a closer look, we can see just right here on the feedback pin, there is a capacitor C4, I think, yeah, the C4 capacitor, 10 microfarad one, that operates this MOSFET, and it is connected to the feedback circuit that goes to the optocoupler, that drives the optocoupler. So quite an important capacitor there. A couple of few more things I would like to do is the solder joints look a bit crusty on the relay, so I'm going to remove them and test them, of course. And then we are going to check, let's do it now. So let's measure this one. I have my dodgy set up here, and let's try to take a measurement. Nope. And there we go. 2.9 microfarads and 10 ohm, if I see correctly. ESR. That's definitely a bad capacitor. Now let's remove the other, the relays, to do a check off board, and let's remove our capacitor. Let's take this capacitor out using my preferred method, of course. There we go. Oh, it looks like it has leaked a bit. Yeah, possibly. Remove those two pins. Oh, this is very big for the zob. Nope. So I've checked the relays. Some of them needed a bit of attention. And let's get to the main problem. This capacitor here. Of course, I had in stock an FR one, very luckily. I will add a bit of solder to the SMD pads. There we go. A bit of solder to the pins of the capacitor. And I sorted the pins there. A bit of new solder, I think, will do the trick. There we go, one there. And another one there. Let's take a look. Still sorted between the legs. There we go. That is much better. Let me take a look with the eyepiece. So our capacitor is there. A bit of a cleaning, and let's test to see if there is any difference. So, moment of truth. Everything is back together. Let's start it up and see if there is any difference. So unfortunately, we won't be able to test this one here. As I read in a forum that has a lot of information about these inverters, link of course down in the description. In older models, the AC measurement is not displayed if only one phase is connected. Also, I noticed in this hardware version that only L1 is supplying power to the SMPS power supplies of the inverter. So I'm pretty sure the other one did work with L2 and L3. We will have to wait for the feedback from the customer if this works, but don't forget, 9 out of 10 situations, this capacitor will solve the problem. And it is solely the suspect for not starting or DC bus not engaging. Hit the like button if you found this video helpful, and please consider subscribing for more repair videos. It really helps the channel and me personally. Thank you for watching, and see you on the next one. Bye!